Can you explain hail damage to asphalt shingle roof?
Storms tend to get stronger when they move in Dallas, so it's part of the reason why they get so much hail.
Now it hails a lot in the cities and states that never hailed before. What causes that?
I mean, imagine if we could forecast today in Minneapolis, you guys are gonna get hailstorms, but they're gonna be soft. So you're probably not gonna see that much damage.
Explain scientifically hail, how it causes and what's behind it. Many people don't understand what hail is, why we have hail capital, like in Colorado, like what it has to do with geology and.
Okay, so hail, so in our atmosphere, our temperature, the ground is one temperature, but as you go up, the temperature gets colder, which is an instability issue because warm air wants to rise. And so when it's really cold up here, the warm air really wants to rise faster, right? So if you think in your house, the bottom floor is always cooler than the top floor because the warm air rises up there, right? So it's that same concept happens in our atmosphere, and that creates lift. So lift is the air rising. And when we can focus that lift, so if we get a front that comes in, it will focus the lift. And so it'll increase the speed that the air is lifting in the atmosphere. So when we do that, it causes a thunderstorm to form. And inside that thunderstorm continues to increase that lift. And so the faster and stronger that lift is, so let's say you have a raindrop that weighs, you know, a couple ounces, right? An ounce. I don't know how much a raindrop weighs, but so
you should know.
I should know that, right? So as that raindrop is trying to fall, the air is lifting underneath it, so it pushes it up. And it gets up to a point, usually between 10,000, 15,000 feet up, it goes below freezing. And so it freezes, or you can have what's called super cooled, which is liquid that's not frozen, and when something touches it, it freezes instantly. So that happens, and it literally cycles up and down. So the storm has an updraft, a lift section, and it also has a fall section. It's just like an engine. It has to breathe in and exhale out. And as long as everything is aligned properly, it can get stronger and stronger and stronger. So that stone goes up and down and it makes these revolutions. And it will do that until that lift is no longer.
I like the word revolution.
Revolution, yeah, it's a good
one,
right?
We need one where I'm coming from.
You're right. It's a long time coming. So as that happens, it goes and goes until it's till this hailstone that's now formed, right? And it's got these rings inside of it. You've seen that, until it's too heavy and it can no longer support it. So a golf ball is 74 mile per hour winds lifting up. That's so when we hit 74, it can no longer hold the golf ball and it will fall to the ground. Mm-hmm. So baseball is like 100, right? So think about that air is, you wouldn't want to be flying into that. but that's literally what happens. And then it falls to the ground when the weight is too much and it can't hold it anymore.
Very cool. Very cool explanation. I mean, I've read about it. I've seen sort of a few classes. And it always fascinates me.
Like it's really neat. Storm
so
chasing.
Why work. Dallas and Colorado? What's up with this?
Well, so Colorado gets it. It's called orographic lift. The mountains are the lift mechanism. So the air blows off the plains and it shoots up the mountain and it causes lift, creates a thunderstorm. It rolls out and drops its hail. So there's a little another, the Palmer Divide is part of Colorado's geography, and that's literally a mountain streak that kind of comes out and then goes down south of Denver. If you've ever flown into Denver, you see the mountains to the west, but then there's also some hills that kind of go to the south. That actually causes shear or spin, and which makes that inflow outflow, the breathing of the storm, makes that happen better in Denver than it does in other parts of the country. So that's why they get a lot of hail. Dallas, there's a lot of reasons. The plains are a great spot for storms, just generally. Another thing, Dallas is massive. It's huge. It's hard for a hailstorm to miss that city because it's so big. But they also have an urban heat island. They're at night, they're 10 degrees warmer than all the air around them. And remember when we talked about we want that warm and cold, we want that spread to be bigger. So you have a bigger spread in Dallas. So storms tend to get stronger when they move into Dallas. So it's part of the reason why they get so much hail.
But now it hails a lot in the cities and states that never hailed before, like Atlanta gets hail, and all over the country. What causes that?
So it's actually
global warp.
Well, no. So yeah. So actually, so I would argue that we don't get more hail in the U.S. now than we ever have. It gets reported more now. It gets known more. So social media, just like all the issues that we have, get magnified. Right. The same thing happens with our storms. They get magnified. People see them. But if you go back and look, it's pretty neutral. I mean, you have your peak years and you have your down year. We've actually been in a below average streak for like the last 3 years in the U.S. We've had less hail than normal.
Great point with the social media.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen your truck earlier, the pullout, the sample with the roof. Mm-hmm. You've installed the roof. You've tested it with the hail. Can you explain hail damage to asphalt shingle roof?
Well, so I'm definitely not a damage expert, right? So that's not
But you have it. You've tested it. What was your findings like when you've done it? When you took a roof mm-hmm. in an area where it just hailed, mm-hmm. like what did you see?
Well, so the interesting thing is that hail size isn't always, like, it's not the perfect indicator for damage on a roof. I've taken shingles in baseball size hail and they did not receive damage, which is always interesting, right? You're like, God, that's hail like that. How did it not damage the roof? And that's because hail has different densities inside of it. This is part of what we don't know, which is why we're doing this. We want to understand hard and soft hail. I want to know, this storm, did it produce hard or soft hail? And then I can start to analyze the atmosphere and try to learn what was it that caused hard and soft hail in that particular storm. So we can, you know, I mean, imagine if we could forecast today in Minneapolis, you guys are going to get hailstorms, but they're going to be soft. So you're probably not going to see that much damage. Like, that would save guys like Ben, right? Knocking doors, right? He's like, I knocked 1,000 doors. I haven't seen any damage, you know? Well, that would save him and allow him to work the area where it makes more sense. So, you know, we want to continue to try and progress what we've built, right? So if you look at the history of weather data to the roofing industry in 2000, it was NOAA storm reports. So they saw a little green blip on the map and they ran to that green dot. Sometimes it was in the right spot. Sometimes it was in the wrong spot. They just, whatever they found. Around 2008, 2009, 2010, companies started making these maps that drew out where it held at. So our next, we want to show you not where it held at or not that it was 2-inch hail. We want to say, here it was damaging, here it wasn't. And there's a lot of research that's going to go on to make that happen, but that's our goal. That's what we want to try.
So you're still developing technology, software.
Mm-hmm.
It's not as easy as just documenting a report, and it's actually predicting. Yeah. You're in business of predicting.
Yeah, and we want to get better, right? Like I feel like, you know, roofing contractors, your goal should be to get better and better and better. You know, hopefully your competition helps to drive that. But, you know, you want to continue to get better. If you're setting still, somebody will pass you. And so we want to get better at what we do. And so we try really hard to do that.
And I was thinking when you were talking soft and hard hail, it's almost like size of the bullet. They say that smaller bullets are more dangerous to bodies mm-hmm. because it travels inside your body, where a bigger bullet, people think, well, you make more damage, but it actually stops, explodes at the face, so it'll knock you down.
Yeah.
But it's actually better to get shot by a bigger caliber bullet than a smaller one. They're less fatal. Interesting fact.
I don't want to test that, though.
I wouldn't.